This time, our boys and girls are dismissed to our children's church. Parents, if you want to go with them and see where they're headed, so you'll know where to pick them up, you are welcome to go back there with them. We are grateful for our children's ministry, children's workers, and all that God continues to do in the life of the church. Amen? Well, if you brought your Bibles with you, hope that you did, turn with me to the book of Joshua. We continue our theme from creation to the cross. We're kind of doing a survey of the scriptures, just kind of hitting the highlights, the high points. We find ourselves in the book of Joshua. The book of Joshua really is filled with some wonderful stories that are amazing stories of God moving, God working in the hearts and lives of His people in mighty and miraculous ways. We really could camp out in the book of Joshua for quite some time looking at some of these stories, but because of the series that we're doing, the lineup that we're doing, trying to make our way through the scriptures, we're just going to hit some highlights this morning. And I just want to kind of give you kind of a little overview of the book of Joshua and some of the great stories that take place there. As you know, of course, the Israelite people, God delivered them out of the bondage and slavery of Egypt, used Moses to do that, was taking them to the promised land. They got to the edge of the promised land. They sent the 12 spies over into the promised land, and 10 of those 12 came back saying, "There is no way we can do this. It's impossible." And only two, Joshua and Caleb, were the only two that felt like that God was in this, that God was with them. And so as a result of their disobedience to the things of God, they found themselves exiled, really, to that wilderness region for the next about 40 years. And only Joshua and Caleb, along with those younger generation, would cross over into this new promised land. And so we find ourselves here as again, Moses has passed away. Joshua is there leading the people, and once again, he decides to send some spies over into the land of Canaan to find out some details about how they would work out. This time, he probably maybe made a little better decision, I don't know, but he did not get as many spies. How many of you know that sometimes it's hard to get anything done when you got too many cooks in the kitchen? Well, that's often the case. So this time, Joshua sends just two spies. And they go over into the promised land. They make their way into Jericho, and they're spying out the land. While they're in Jericho, we find here in Joshua the third chapter, or the second chapter, I guess it is. We find them making their way through this city, and their spies are being tracked. They're being found out, and so Joshua and are these two spies, they make their way into the home of Rahab, a prostitute. And they go into that place. Maybe it's a good hiding place. It's a good place to hide out. Nobody would think to look for them there. And Rahab, the prostitute, lives up on the city wall, and she hides them there and enables them to escape. When the guards come looking for these spies, she provides a way of escape for them, spares their life. And as a result, she asked them to do her a favor. And that favor would be that when they would come back and when they would take over the land, that they would remember her and her family. And it's an amazing story of a transformational grace of God, the transformational grace that happens in each and every one of our lives. And the truth of this little truth, the truth of this little story, this part of the book of Joshua is that it doesn't matter where you've come from. Doesn't matter what you've been a part of. It doesn't matter about your past. God has a future for you. Amen. God has a promise. And God wants to work in and through you. And he worked through this prostitute, Rahab. And she turned her heart and life and things over to the things of God and began to follow the ways of God. And then her family was spared. But there's something even more amazing about this story. And that is that Rahab is found in the lineage of King David and the very lineage of our Messiah, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. So this very same woman who was there as a Canaanite prostitute in the city of Jericho, God used to transform not only her life, but future generations. And if God can do that with her, what can He do with you and I? Amen?
Amen.
But she had to make that choice. Then we come down to Joshua, the third chapter, and we find that the spies have come back, and they're telling Joshua and the rest of them the report that they've come back with. And so Joshua gathers the people and says, let's cross over into the promised land. We're going to cross the Jordan River. Now, again, maybe not the best time, maybe not the best thinking, but they do this at flood stage. When the river is flooded and the waters are not just trickling, it's not just a trickling stream, but it is a raging flooded river that is coming down. And God tells them to go and take the Ark of the Covenant and cross over. It tells the priests to go first. They're not going to look for a better place. They're not going to look for a better crossing. They're not going to look for higher ground. They're not going to look for another option. He just says, here's the place. Get the priests, get the Ark of the Covenant, and cross. Now again, maybe not the best choice, maybe not the best option to send the guys carrying the big heavy piano, like piano-like box. You know, you can imagine four guys on this, two on each side, two on that side, and they got this big heavy Ark of the Covenant, they're carrying it through, and let's send them through the flooded waters first, right? Nobody goes in to test it, see how muddy it is, see what it is. But no, that is the plan of God. And they have to make the choice to follow in that footsteps. And the scripture tells us here in Joshua chapter 3, verse 15, it says, and when those carrying the ark came to where the Jordan, and the feet of the priests carrying the ark were submerged at the edge of the water, then, and only then, did the floodwaters recede. The waters backed up, and the Israelites crossed over on dry land. Amazing. Amazing how God works and God moves. And it's one of those things that this young generation, they didn't witness. They probably heard the stories from their parents, from others about the time that their family came out of Egypt and crossed over the Red Sea and came across on dry land, and how God parted the waters and prepared them, but they had never experienced it for themselves. God gave them that opportunity. And they walked across this Jordan River on dry land. And out of that, God called them out of Joshua chapter 4 and challenged them. And he said to have one man from each of the tribes of Israel, so 12 men, to gather stones up out of that river and make a memorial and pile those stones up there as a memorial. So in Joshua chapter 4, verse 21 through 24, he said to the sons of Israel, when your children ask your fathers in time to come, what do these stones mean? You shall let your children know that Israel crossed this Jordan on dry ground. For the Lord your God dried up the waters of the Jordan for you until you crossed over, just as the Lord your God did the Red Sea, which he dried up before us until we had crossed. So that all the people of the earth may know, without any doubt, the Amplified Version adds, and acknowledge that the hand of the Lord is mighty, extraordinary, and powerful, so that you will fear the Lord your God forever. Aren't you grateful for those moments, for those seasons, those times in which God moves in life and in situations and circumstances where He parts the waters, where he makes a way where there seems to be no way, where he answers prayer when you've been crying out on behalf of a situation or circumstance. And it's important for us to make those spiritual markers. It's important for us to pile up those stones. It's important for us to pick up those moments that would remind us of those seasons. Kind of have this weird habit of collecting stones. My wife says I've got rocks in my head, but most of the time they're just in my pocket. I pick up stones that just kind of remind me of significant points and places. And in my closet, I've got a shelf that's got a variety of different stones. But as I pick up those stones, I can remember distinctly on a lot of them exactly where I picked that up and what I picked it up for and what was going on. What was taking place, how God had spoken to me in that situation or circumstance. And it's just a little subtle reminder of the fact that God still parts the waters. we've got to make the choice. We've got to choose to trust him and follow in his footsteps. Then the Israelite people, they crossed over the Jordan River. They're gathering outside of getting ready to move towards the city of Jericho. They're trying to figure out the game plan, how they're going to go forward. And all of a sudden, Joshua looks up and sees this behemoth of a man. I mean, he probably made the rock look tiny. I mean, just this ginormous guy. And he's standing off in the distance, and he's definitely a soldier. He's definitely a man that is dressed for battle. And Joshua is amazing to me, because I probably would have sent somebody else, hey, go check out what that guy's up to. But no, Joshua, he marches right up to this guy, and he sees this ginormous figure there, and he goes to him, and he says, who are you? Whose side are you on? Are you for us or for our enemies? And I love the response here out of Joshua chapter 5, verse 13 and 14. It says, and when Joshua was by Jericho, he looked up, and behold, a man was standing opposite with his sword drawn and in his hand. And Joshua went to him and said, are you for us or for our adversaries? Listen to the response. He says, no, rather I have come now as captain of the Lord's army. And Joshua fell with his face towards the earth and bowed down and said to him, what does my Lord have to say to his servant? Whose side are you on? That was the question that he wanted to know. That was the answer that he was looking for. Whose side are you on? Isn't that the question that we always want to know in situations and circumstances? We always try and figure out whose side the other person is on. A lot of times we're trying to figure out whose side God is on. Is God on my side or is God on their side? Is God with me or is he with them? Is God voting for the Dallas Cowboys? Well, it hadn't been for a while, but anyway. Whose side is he on? Is he Democrat or Republican? Is he liberal or conservative? And the answer comes clearly back as Joshua stands before this behemoth of a man with his sword drawn. And he says, neither. I'm not on either side. I'm the commander of God's army. The simple reality of that truth, of that story, is that God does not choose sides. Can I say that again? God doesn't choose sides. He is the side to choose. He is the side to choose. So when Joshua came to this angel, the Lord's army, wanting to know whose side he was on, he said, neither. We must recognize that God is the side to choose. Then in chapter 6, we find that Joshua is given the instruction by the Lord to how to take the city of Jericho and to march around it for 7 days. And on the seventh day, to march around it 7 times. Again, an amazing story of God's miraculous power, grace, work. We're going to dive more into that in our core groups this week. And so you can kind of read up on that and plan for that as we study together, as we share together in those small groups that meet in homes and different places. We will talk more about that, but think about that and look into that. But as we come down to the end of the book of Joshua, the 24th chapter, Joshua calls the people together and challenges them with these words, Joshua chapter 24, verses 14 and 15. Now therefore, Joshua says, fear the Lord and serve him in sincerity and in truth. Remove the gods which your fathers served on the other side of the Euphrates River and in Egypt, and serve the Lord. If it's unacceptable in your sight to serve the Lord, then choose for yourselves this day whom you will serve, whether your gods which your forefathers served that were on the other side of the river, or the gods of the Amorites in the land in which you live. But as for me and my house, Joshua declares, we will serve the Lord. Amen. As you listen to these amazing stories, and as we just kind of skip over them and just briefly highlight them this morning, we recognize that all of these truths and all of these stories are really about choices. See, Rahab chose to forget about her past and move forward with God and with the people of God. She made a very distinct and very important choice on that day to let go of the past and move forward with God. Maybe that's your choice this morning. Maybe you're stuck in the past. Maybe you're stuck in past habits and past events or past details or past regrets. Maybe you're stuck in things that did happen or didn't happen or should have happened or could have happened. Find ourselves stuck in the past when God wants us to move forward. We live so much of our lives stuck in the choices of the past, and we forget that God is a transforming God that can take a prostitute from a Canaanite land and make her a part of the family and lineage of God Almighty. He can do that with Rahab. How much more can He do with you and I? The Israelites, as they crossed that Jordan, they had to choose to trust God and step into the River Jordan at flood stage. And maybe this morning you stand at the edge of the river and you're not sure, and there's lots of doubts that are flooding your mind, and there are lots of situations that come washing over you, and you're worried about so many little things and so many details, and you say, but this load that I'm carrying is heavy, and this ground is muddy, and it's not safe, and it's not secure, and there's so much problems all around me, I'm not sure which way to go. And again, like the Israelite priest, is like people of God, there's a choice to be made to step out in faith into the flooded waters, trusting that God will provide, trusting that God will protect, trusting that God has a purpose and God has a plan, or to huddle back on the banks and miss out on the promise that God has for us on the other side. The Israelites had to choose to trust God and step out into the river, flooded waters. Joshua, he chose to humble himself before the commander of the Lord's army, recognizing that he couldn't convince God to choose his side, but he had to choose God's side. No matter how hard we try, no matter how good we are, no matter how much effort we put into it, important for us to recognize that God doesn't choose sides. His is the side to choose. We must make that choice. People in the Battle of Jericho, they had to choose to trust God's plan and God's way as they marched around that walled city 7 days in a row. Can you imagine some of the insults that might have come from those up on that wall? What are you idiots doing? What's going on? Look at these numbskulls. What do they think that's going to accomplish? But just faithfully, step after step, day after day, they chose to obey God's will, God's way, God's word. And the walls of opposition, the walls that were obstacles, the walls that seemed like that they would consume us and be too much for us to get around or go under or get through, all just came tumbling down. Yes. When the choice was made to follow and obey God's purpose and God's plan. There's a great little story. It's told about a group that went on a tour in a art museum. the tour guide that was leading them through the art museum would stop and tell them about different paintings and different pieces of art, and then the group would move on to the next piece of art. Until they came to one particular piece of art. The tour guide explained to the group about this painting. It was entitled Checkmate. It's a painting of the devil playing a game of chess against an individual seated there on either side of this chessboard, both of them intently looking, the look of kind of excitement on the face of the devil, look of fear and intrepidation on the heart and mind of the opposing player, because by all intents and purposes the title of the piece was simply Checkmate. The tour guide explained the painting, talked about the painter, and then moved on with the crowd, but one individual stayed back. He stood there for quite some time, staring at that painting, looking intently at all the pieces on the board and all the moves. Finally, the tour guide came back and began to call him on. He said, "Well, the rest of the group is going on. Is everything okay?" And he said, "Well," he said, "I just really am intrigued by this painting." He said, you're either going to have to repaint the painting or change the name." The tour guide looked at him and said, what do you mean?" He said, "Well, I'm a chess master. I've played a lot of chess. And as I studied this board, and I studied these places, and I studied these pieces, I recognize one thing. And it's this. The king still has one more move. So can I tell you something this morning? When you feel like you're pinned down, you feel like there's no way around that obstacle that's standing before you. The walls are high. You can't get in it. You can't get over it. You can't get under it. You can't get around it. When there's a behemoth of a man standing before you, when there's an invading army, when there's problems, when the river's at flood stage, it doesn't seem like there's any choices. Can I tell you? The King of Kings always has another move. My King, your King, our Lord and Savior always has another move. It may not be obvious to you. It may not make sense to you. It may not come out in everything that you're looking at, everything that you understand, but guess what? God is omnipotent, omniscient, omnipresent. That just means he's all-powerful, he's all-knowing, and he's everywhere at all times, and he has everything well under control. We just come to that point and place in which we choose him. And I think there are times in which we need to meditate less on the mess. I've discovered God doesn't bless mess. And sometimes we spend so much time thinking about the mess and worrying about what's going to happen and focused on the negative and focused on the problems, when God is a victorious God who wants to deliver us, who wants to deliver people like Rahab and her family and use them for his kingdom, for his glory. He's the one that wants to lead us out into the flood stage of the River Jordan and help us to cross over on dry land if we're willing to take those steps of faith and put our feet in. He's the one that wants to give us those memorial stones, those places that we can look back and we can remember that God has been faithful all of this time, and he's never going to let us down yet. He's the one that we can stand before that opposition that looks like there's this behemoth of a man in front of us and we don't know which way to choose, but we know that he is the side to choose. When those walls walls are surrounding us and we don't know which way to look and we don't know which way to turn, we can just trust that God has called us, and our only responsibility is to be obedient, to be faithful to His call, and trust that He will work out all the details. Like Joshua challenged the people of God, I believe God wants to challenge you and I. He wants the same way. We've got a choice to make. Simple reality is, in every situation, in every circumstance, there is always a choice. You may convince yourself that you don't have a choice, and there's no other choice, and you've got to do what you've got to do, you had to do what you had to do, or you're going to do what you're going to do. But the simple reality is that there's always a choice. So Joshua challenges the people. I believe God challenges us this day. And we're going to have to make a choice. Whether we will serve the gods of this land, the gods of this world, or if we will choose this day to serve the Lord. I'm going to ask our musicians to come. I'm going to sing this closing song, simply entitled, "Lord, I Need You." Every hour, I need you. I believe there's a powerful truth that comes with this. It says, "Lord, I come, I confess. Bowing here, I find my rest. And without you, I fall apart. You're the one who guides my heart. Where sin runs deep, your grace is more. Where grace is found is where you are. And where you are, Lord, is where I'm free. Holiness is Christ in me. So teach my song to rise to you. When temptation comes my way, and when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you are my hope and stay. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour," the chorus says, "I need you. My one defense, my righteousness, oh God, how I need you." As we sing this morning, I just invite you to worship. I just invite you to respond however God leads you this morning. But as we're faced with the choices this morning, this day, this week, I want to challenge us to choose Him. Let's sing together. You respond however God leads you. Thank you. I need you. Hear my hope and say. Would you choose this day?
Whom you'll serve.
Choose His grace, His mercy. In each and every situation and circumstance, let's choose Him. Father in heaven, thank you for this day that you have blessed us with. Thank you, O God, for the privilege that is ours to gather in this place, in this moment, in this season, in this time, to worship you in everything that is said and done. I pray, God, that you would just continue to lead us and guide us as we go from this place, not going from your presence. May you go with us. May you guide us. May you direct us. May we go with you better yet, O God. May we follow in your footsteps as our loving temple shepherd. Thank you for what you've done. Thank you for what you're doing. Thank you for this time in which we've shared and celebrated. Pray, O God, that you bless those who couldn't be able to be here this morning. That you administer in them and to them and through them. Have your will and your way in Christ's name. All God's people said.
Amen.
We look forward to seeing you this evening. It'll be at 6 o'clock in the gymnasium. It'll be our fellowship for Hannah and Catherine. God bless you. We'll see you this evening.